Dr. Padnekar, Sudhindra Kulkarni, my old friend, members of the Observer Research Foundation, students, teachers of Ruya College, ladies and gentlemen, I feel somehow very touched and honored that I am here to tell you something about Albert Einstein. And in a sense, I do work in the area which is of science, which is taking forward the legacy of Albert Einstein. So this talk, I have worked very hard to prepare because I'm neither an astrophysicist nor a professional relativist nor a cosmologist. I have learned a lot preparing this talk, and perhaps that will make this talk perhaps a little bit difficult. But I'll try to transfer to you this excitement about Albert Einstein and his place in the history of science. Okay, with these few words, let me just begin my talk. I think I have to press yes here. So this is Albert Einstein, and so about 100 years ago, in 1915, in a series of weekly presentations every Thursday to the Prussian Academy in Berlin, Albert Einstein put forth his general theory of relativity. The first talk was on November 4th, then 11th, 18th, 25th. The equations presented on November 4th were wrong. And this is the thing about Einstein, actually, that he was struggling all the time, trying to do things right. He has made so many mistakes, actually, in arriving at the truth, that he always used to say that only the hand that he raises can write the true thing. And this is from a mistake called Meister Eckhart. This is a very favorite quotation of Einstein. Only the hand that he raises can write the true thing. So on November 25th, the right equations were presented, which satisfied a few constraints. And I will just mentioned here the name of the publication, actually, of the lecture to the Prussian Academy. I cannot speak or read German very well, so I will not attempt to read it out. But in short, general relativity overturned the Newtonian view where space is a static arena and time is absolute and unchanging. In general relativity, which is called GR throughout this talk now, space-time is a dynamic arena and gravitation is a consequence of the curvature of space-time. I'll explain these things somewhat. So this is just a summary, and we will trace this incredible journey from Newton to Einstein and beyond in this talk. So we have to begin with the birth of theory in modern science, that is the Principia Mathematica of Newton in 1687. And the idea is the following, and this looks all very trivial today, but the idea that you have a coordinate system, you know, in tree space you have three coordinates, you assign a position to a point, and when this point, this particles or whatever moves, you trace it in some parameter called time. So the idea of time is to keep track of motion, essentially, okay? And so this is the picture over here. Is there a pointer for the screen, please? Or something which I can... Okay, all right. Oh. Okay, thank you. Yeah. So yeah, okay. So these are the three coordinates, and this is the you know, you can trace a curve as you change t from, you know, 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., etc.
And the important point actually is that time is absolute and the same for all observers. Means, you know, if you are traveling by train and you are looking at your watch, and I'm sitting here, we all have synchronized our watches. I mean, there is no difference between 11 o'clock here, 11 o'clock on the train, or in a plane, or wherever. So this is the first point that goes into the description of the laws of nature by Newton. And then the second thing is, of course, Newton's very famous equation that the acceleration of an object, how it moves, is proportional to the force that acts on it. And the proportionality constant is a very important thing. It's called the inertial mass. You know, if it's a very heavy object, it's difficult to move it, right, than a lighter object. So it has more inertia. Okay. So this equation encapsulates those ideas. All right. There's one more thing that Newton did, like many other things he did, but in mechanics, that he formulated the universal law of gravitation, that if you have a mass m1 and a mass m2, then both of them are attracted. They respond to each other by a force. He introduced the concept, it's a very abstract concept of force between two objects, which enables them to attract each other. It's a description, basically, rather than an explanation. And this is the famous inverse square law. Okay, it's proportional to the product of the masses of these objects. And the thing I like to point out to you from the Principia, the various editions, is that Newton was aware, he was aware more than any of his contemporaries or people who came after him, till Einstein, of the basic problem with this law. So I just read out that I have not been able to discover the cause of these properties of gravity from phenomena, and I feign no hypothesis. It is enough that gravity does really exist and acts according to the laws I have explained, and then it abundantly serves to account for all the motions of celestial bodies. And it's because it was able to account for all the motions of the celestial bodies that people said, let's accept it, let's go forward, and not bother too much about the deeper meaning of this law. One historical point is that it is 111 years after the introduction of the law of gravitation by Newton that it was first tested in a laboratory by Cavendish. I mean, there was a century between the way this law was derived using basically, you know, astronomical ideas about the motion of planets. There was a 100-year gap between that and the laboratory tabletop experiment, which verified this law. Okay? All right. That's for Newton. Two slides. Now we go to the next big revolution of physics or science. This is perhaps one of the most important contributions of the 19th century. And this is James Clerk Maxwell. As a young person, he was very young actually when he died. But in his lifetime, he unified electricity and magnetism and predicted the existence of electromagnetic waves. So he unified optics with electricity and magnetism. You know, a lot of science is about unification of ideas. And this was the first or the second great unification, actually. And so his equations predicted that light moves with this particular speed in vacuum. In a material, of course, this speed will slow down, but that's another matter. That's a matter of detail. So this particular idea that electromagnetic waves move at the speed of light and that electromagnetism really acts in a causal way, means if I have a charge here and I have a charge here, if I move this, it'll take the time, which is the distance divided by the speed of light, for this to respond. Okay. So this idea that something propagates to influence one object to another in a finite time with a finite speed is the central contribution of Maxwell to what was coming in relativity. So, you know, in Newton's theory, if you have two masses over here, and if I move this, immediately it will move. So it's like this. instantaneous interaction, and that is the big problem, actually, as you'll see later on. All right, so this contribution of Maxwell immediately had profound implications for the development of physics. And in 1905, Albert Einstein, precisely based on this particular point, put forth the special theory of relativity. The special theory of relativity basically hinges, actually, as most of this talk hinges on the fact that the speed of light is finite and influences in nature travel with a finite speed. Okay, this is the key point of this entire talk, and you'll see that general relativity also emerges in some sense from this type of an idea. So here is a simple thought experiment, very much like the way Einstein used to like to discuss physics. Here is a rocket, and there is an observer here. And there is a mirror and a source of light, and the light goes, keep on coming up and down, up and down, up and down. So let us look at the time it takes for the light to go from here to here. Okay, call it delta t, okay, just some symbol. Now there is some girl standing over here, and she is looking at this rocket, you see. Because the speed of light is finite, you know, the Earth observer, or she, will see light has traveled further. Obviously, it's given out from here. This spaceship has moved. So the light goes here, reflects off the mirror, and is absorbed over here. That's it. Based on this very elementary observation and using elementary geometry, you can arrive at this very famous equation, which says that the time that this observer will see of this particular event of the light going up and down, as opposed to what this will see, is basically scaled by a certain factor, 1 minus v square upon c square, and v is the speed of the rocket, actually. Okay, so this is the, you know, the central point of the special theory of relativity, that the speed of light is finite, and if the speed of light is finite, then space and time have to sort of adjust themselves to bring that about. So this is a very important thing, that time moves slower for this person, actually, for this person, okay? All right, so this was the special theory of relativity. Now, I'm just going from one great contribution to another. So this special theory of relativity of Einstein talked about space and time mingling around with each other, okay? They have to adjust themselves. This Hermann Minkowski was a famous mathematician, was also the teacher of Einstein at the ETH in Zurich, okay? And he made one very fundamental contribution, that he said that let us look at time essentially as one additional component and talk of three components of space and one component of time. So you talk of four-dimensional space-time rather than three space and one time. Because in Newton's theory, it was okay to do that because time was the same for everybody. But now time is mixing with space, actually. It depends upon your state of motion. And therefore, let us talk about space and time in the same breath and talk about four-dimensional space-time, okay? And there's a very famous quote from Minkowski, henceforth space by itself and time by itself are doomed to fade away into mere shadows, and only a kind of union of the two will preserve an independent reality. So this is what Minkowski said. Let us call the speed of light times time as one further dimension, x4, and the distance between two nearby points in time and two nearby points in space can be denoted by this simple distance law. And this is just a generalization of what we really have in Euclid's geometry. This is nothing but the Pythagoras theorem. The distance of the hypotenuse is the square of the base plus the square of the other side, right? So this is a generalization of ordinary geometry with this minus sign in between, okay? Whatever that is, this is what it is. And this leads to some very interesting mathematical consequences, but we shall not dwell on them at the moment. Okay, so we had Maxwell's theory, finite speed of light. Einstein saw the deep implication of it. that space and time have to change in order to maintain that. It's a very funny thing, I'll tell you why. Because it says that if you have a bulb, somebody is lighting a bulb there and you run towards the bulb, or you run away from the bulb, the speed of light is the same. Just think about it, this is weird really. Because if you, you know, if there is a train coming and you are running towards it, you will see it coming faster, right? And if you are running away from it, you know, with it, you will see it running slower. So how does this happen? I leave this as a question to you to ponder about. How does this happen actually? And in order to answer this question, the special theory of relativity was actually invented. Okay? All right. Let's go on. Now that we have special relativity, everything is fine. We understand many things about the real world. Special relativity was tested time and again in the decades to come to precisions which are unbelievable. But Einstein did not function this way in science, actually. You know, he has a theory, it explains experiments, but he was always worried about puzzles and contradictions, you know, how to move forward by resolution of contradiction. Some famous German philosopher has said that before, and we all know that. I mean, that was Marx. So, there were two puzzles he noted. And one of them I've already told you, that in Newton's law of gravitation, the force of gravity acts instantaneously. Now, this is certainly not consistent with special relativity. Okay, you might say that there's instantaneous action here for me, but now if you start moving with respect to me, I have explained to you that this event and this event cannot be instantaneous, right? There will be a time delay. So there must be a big problem, actually, with Newton's law of gravitation. And this is serious business, you see, because Newton's law of gravitation has been established over maybe more than 200 years. It has experimental verification in trying to understand the planets of orbits, of the orbits of planets, comets, celestial objects, military applications, all types of things actually on Earth. So to find a problem with that law is an amazing thing actually, and then you go about trying to fix that actually, and that's our story basically. So now Einstein would like to have the force of gravity communicated at the speed of light by a field analogous the electromagnetic field of Faraday and Maxwell, which we are all familiar with. So what is this field that communicates gravity? That is the main part of our story, actually. And the second point, which seems to have a problem in Einstein's mind, is that special relativity, the relativity that we just talked about, is restricted to frames which are, you know, moving at constant velocity with respect to each other. So up till now, the invariance of the laws of physics had to do with frames which moved at constant velocities only with respect to each other. Okay, so this is why in the cartoon I showed you about the spaceship, the rocket was actually moving at a constant speed. So that was worrying Einstein actually. Why is it that we have to demand the invariance of the laws of nature only under these very special frames, you know, which move with respect to each other at constant velocity? That was bothering him. So now, both of these problems are resolved by a very amazing thought he had sitting in his office one day in 1907. I think it's in Bern, and this is what he calls the principle of equivalence. And Einstein calls it the happiest or luckiest thought of his life. It is in German, so it depends upon how you translate it. Some say happiest, some say luckiest. I think they are not inconsistent. If you are lucky, you are happy. So, all right. So now we go on to how the general theory of relativity unfolds, actually. How does this man go about solving this problem? He's alone in this quest. Nobody has thought about all these things. So we have to go to go back to one of the great pioneers of the modern scientific method, Galileo Galilei, And you all know, actually, about this famous Tower of Pisa experiment. It's just a cartoon. I am not so sure that he really did the experiment. But the key point is that the inertial mass that appears in Newton's law and the mass of an object which responds to gravity, these two are the same. Okay, this is the key point, actually, that these two masses are the same. And today with lot of our modern technology, as of the 1990s, this equation is known to a precision of 1 part in 10 to the 13. Okay, 1 with 13 zeros. You know, it's one of the most accurate known scientific laws that we know. The equality of the inertial and gravitational masses. Okay, so this is the key point, that this is true. See, so you have F equal to ma, and if you're on Earth, then, the force of gravity is mg, right? These two m's are in principle different, but if they're equal, they cancel. See, this is the key point, that the force of gravity has the gravitational mass in front, and the force law of Newton, which talks of acceleration, has the inertial mass. These two are equal, and they don't appear in the equation. You see, this is a very important point. So I read recently Einstein's own writings about how he thought. Now, here it is. You see, we have been brought up with the idea since the time of Newton that there is a force and you respond to it, okay? So there is the force of gravity and matter responds to it and accelerates. Einstein turned it around. He said that the only way you can perceive gravity is by looking at acceleration because of the equality of the inertial and gravitational mass, right? So this is the great turning point, that Einstein felt that gravity, constant gravitational fields, can be equivalent. That's the principle of equivalence to constant accelerations. Okay. So this is the great insight. And so in 1907 he had this idea: the effect of a constant gravitational field is equivalent to a uniformly accelerated frame. Now I'll just explain to you what this means, okay? So suppose you have a guy on Earth, all right, and we all feel that the force of gravity is pulling us. It's pulling us, but we are not falling because the stage is pushing on me, and so I have weight, okay? If the stage was somehow falling down also with the same gravitational field, I would feel weightless, right? And if I throw some object actually on the floor, it will basically fall according to Newton's law of gravity, okay? This is the Newton's law of gravity. Now Einstein said that let's forget about, take note of this experiment that you did, which we are familiar with every day in life. But now look at it as follows: they go very far away from any gravitational field in a rocket. Okay, the rocket is just sailing along, you're floating in the rocket because there's no gravity, some cups and saucers are around you, etc. Now suddenly the rocket starts accelerating. The engines are turned on and the rocket starts accelerating. So what will happen? You were floating, the floor will come and hit you, right? And you will press against the floor. The cups and saucers and the balls, which are all around you, floating, will also look like falling to the floor of the spaceship because the spaceship is accelerating up. Okay? And the principle of equivalence says basically that there is no experiment you can perform which can distinguish between these two phenomena. Okay? And this is the real take-home point for you, that next time when you sit in a car and you start accelerating, what will happen? You'll fall backward, right? And when you brake, you'll fall in front. So these are things you attribute to acceleration, right? It's very much like what I'm saying is the fall when the car brakes or accelerates is identical to the fall that you believe you understand in the Earth's gravitational field. It's the same phenomena. And this is the key point of this talk. It's the take-home point. that you can simulate constant gravitational fields by accelerating frames. So he solved two main problems in one shot. You understand gravity in terms of accelerations, accelerating frames. But you know, it's much more, it's a little bit complex. And because it is complex, it took from 1907 to 1915 to really arrive at this full theory. I mean, from this thought to arrive at the equations of Einstein is an amazing struggle, actually, which you should read about sometimes. Actually, the scientists really have a hard life. They struggle to discover the laws of nature. Okay, so this is true over sufficiently small regions of space-time in a non-uniform gravitational field. And just let me explain that to you very briefly, that clearly, you know, the Earth is a sphere, right? So, you know, if you are really 2 miles apart or 2 kilometers apart, two guys on these elevators or coming down, then clearly both of them are falling towards the center of the Earth, right? And the Earth's gravitational field is not really constant. So what happens is basically they will find that there are 2 balls they are dropping will start attracting themselves this way. This is the gravitational tidal force. Okay. So this statement which I made is only true in the small, for small times and for small localities. Okay. Now this must raise a question in your mind, actually. Where have I seen this before? That something like the surface of a sphere is curved. But if I am a small bug, you know, crawling on it, I will see the surface of the sphere as made up of patches of planes, right? We can always approximate any complicated curved surface in terms of patches of the plane. Where ordinary Euclidean geometry works, this is the big connect, actually. This is the big connect that accelerating reference frames or inertial reference frames, when they are all patched up together, create a space-time. And this brings us into the realm of some very advanced mathematics. No need to bother about it, because Mr. Einstein didn't know about this, actually. And it was a major struggle how to get to it. And the first thing he did in 1912, first thing when he reached Zurich, he contacted his friend Marcel Grossmann, who was a mathematician. And Grossmann and Einstein almost arrived at the Einstein equations around 1912, but discarded it for some reasons, etc. I won't go into those details. So this is the idea of how geometry creeps into the description of space-time. Okay, so constancy of speed of light, Minkowski's contribution, that's a four-dimensional geometry. And now this geometry is getting distorted, you see. There are distortions. Whenever there is mass or gravity, geometry is getting distorted. So I'll explain that a little bit with some pictures later on. Okay, so now, here is one of the important implications of the equivalence principle. And I won't tell you how we arrive at this, but I'll just tell you the startling fact. And that the equivalence principle implies that time flows different for 2 observers in a gravitational field. So let's look at these 2 guys who are separated by, you know, in a building, top ground floor and top floor. The building is, let's say, 100 meters, okay? I will tell you the implications of that 100 meters in a second. Okay, so both of them have the same devices, the same clocks, okay, same company. They work the same. And now they start the clock. You see this guy, the clock is moving faster. The clock is moving slower. So this is a profound fact, that clocks move slower when the gravitational field is strong, because the gravitational field near the Earth is obviously stronger than if you go up, clearly. So this is another take-home statement, that wherever the gravity is strong, clocks go slower. Okay. And because this is 100 meters, you can actually make a very simple calculation. to show that the difference of the time they measure is not according to this animation, but it's one part in 10 to the 15, very, very small, okay? However, it is this small difference is actually, when you talk about the GPS, you're talking about satellites communicating with you, and satellites are, you know, up there at something like 20,000 miles or something. So this time delay actually makes a very important difference in the functioning of the global positioning system. So all, you know, we are all familiar with you know, Google Maps and all, and trying to find out where we are and how fast we are moving and where we are moving. This, without the general relativity correction, this one and plus something else, which I cannot explain at the moment, which is also from GR, gives the great accuracy of the global positioning system. I'll say only that, about the positioning system. Let me move on with something else. So here we come to the main cartoon. So what did Einstein really arrive at? Now I'm just going to tell you what he arrived at, okay, rather than, you know, really in detail chart the road. He arrived at the following idea, that if you have a mass, let's say like the Earth, a big mass, it distorts the space-time around it. You know, it's like you have a rubber sheet, you know, stretched between, you know, with a ring or a trampoline, you know, and you put a heavy mass, it'll bend actually. So the fabric of the trampoline will bend, okay? So this is a cartoon of space-time, how it looks around planet Earth. And this is really an experiment which was done by NASA's gravity probe for several years, which tested Einstein's general theory of relativity to amazing accuracy, that truly time slows down in the way I explained. And also, it's not only time slowing down, but something interesting happens. Remember, if you have a tub of water and you have a volleyball in it, let's say, and you turn the volleyball, there's a drag of the water around the volleyball, right? Yes. Clearly. So what this experiment measured is that the space-time is also dragged around by the Earth as it spins. Okay, this amazing phenomena was actually, you know, detected and observed by NASA's Gravity Probe B. So we come to the great conclusion that there is really no gravity. There's really no gravity. Gravity, the force of gravity which you thought was something, is basically communicated by the curvature, the warping, the stretching of space-time by big masses. And the response of that, in that of, you know, some small mass. For example, if you take a trampoline and put a heavy object in the middle, and you take a small ping pong ball and throw it, it'll go circling around and then it'll fall inside, right? It will look as if there is a gravitational field, but it's just the warping of space-time that causes objects to move with respect to each other. So this communication of the warping is at the speed of light. So this is the big achievement of the Einstein theory. This is the general theory of relativity in pictures, okay? Where gravity is not there, it's explained in terms of the warping of space-time. And there's a very famous quote from John Wheeler that says that matter tells space-time how to curve, and curved space-time tells matter how to move. Okay, so this is a take-home message also from John Wheeler. Now, so the equations of space-time geometry, Einstein made the space-time grid fluid, communicative and causal. You know, the space-time is not something static. In special relativity, only time and space change in a linear way, but now it's the arena in which you discuss the laws of physics is dynamic, actually. You know, it is moving, twisting, turning, depending upon what matter does to it, okay? And the most dramatic things, of course, happen, and I don't have the time to tell it to you, is then there is a black hole. What happens when there's a black hole is another long, big story, actually. Maybe I'll come and talk to you about that some other time. So just as the equations of fluid dynamics describe the flow of fluids, the equations of general relativity describe the shape changes of geometry or the fabric of space-time caused by massive objects in which other objects move. This explains gravity without gravity. And in fact, small shape changes by big objects moving are communicated as gravitational waves, whose detection is a central experimental challenge of our times, and I'll come to it towards the end of my talk. Okay, so here, in this talk, I have to tell you how the Einstein equations look. These are the correct equations. This term was not there in 1915. It's the cosmological constant term, which was introduced much later. And in the first lecture on November 4th, this term was not there, you see. Because this term was not there, this equation is not consistent. That can be seen rather easily, but I don't expect you to worry about that at the moment. But just believe me that on November 4th, this term was not there. On November 25th, this term appears. And these are then the complete equations of general relativity. The left-hand side is related to the curvature of space-time. And the right-hand side is related to matter. This is the stress tensor of matter. You have a mass, it'll show up on the right-hand side. If mass is moving, it'll show up over here. Okay. So this is about matter, and this is about geometry. Okay. Now, there's one more law, actually, which I haven't written down in equations. So, you know, I mean, you have matter, it produces gravity, it produces curved space-time. Now, how do you describe the equation of a particle that is moving in this space-time, in this so-called gravitational field? So there's another law for it, and this is beautiful, really. So it says the following, that the trajectory of any particle in a curved space-time is described as follows by a very simple idea, that you take a clock and put it on the particle, okay? So the particle or some fellow living on it will, time the clock. It's called a proper time. And the trajectory will be simply such that it takes the maximum time for the particle to move from point A to point B in a gravitational field. And I invite you to the following exercise, those of you who want to do something more here, that if you throw a ball from here, it'll go in a parabola, right? From here to there, or, artillery shell or whatever. You can show that this particular motion, which you're very familiar with in the Earth's gravitational field described by Newton's laws, also comes out exactly from this principle if the velocity of the ball is much less than the speed of light. Okay, so these are the two equations, one in words and one really in formulas that were put forth by Einstein on November 24th. And now, of course, you have a great theory, but Einstein was very worried whether this theory is right, because, if this is right, then there's a problem with Newton's theory. This is established truth. There's an analogy here in society with the problem of with problems of religion, problems of God, two gods, three gods, whatever. All those established notions. If you try to overthrow them, you need substantive proof. And in science, it's very easy, okay? Because in science, a statement is true or false depending on whether it agrees with experiment or not. I think this is the great strength of science. So there are three famous experiments which verified Einstein's theory. So this is the redshift. So the redshift problem is the same as the time dilation problem, but I'll explain to you. You have a very heavy mass over here, and there's a laboratory here that sends out a beam of very high frequency blue light. Blue light is high frequency, right? Because if you raise the frequency, it becomes ultraviolet and gamma rays and so on, right? So very high frequency light. Now, there is another mass actually far away, okay? And this mass then receives this light. And this light that this mass receives, the observer over here receives, becomes red. Red in the sense that its wavelength becomes long. Amazing. By just traveling up the gravitational field or by using the principle of equivalence, we can show that this really happens. that blue light, this shone from here, arrives here as red. That is, wavelength is stretched. And there's a very simple formula that says the stretch in the wavelength is just the difference of the gravitational potential divided by c square. You can calculate this. And this was first verified in a brilliant experiment by Pound and Repka at Harvard University. I have seen that shaft actually between two floors where this experiment was done, and all the equipment was carried by Pound and Repka on their backs. There were no elevators at that time there. It's a very old building. Okay, so this was verified in 1959. Then, of course, there are very, very strong and very powerful, highly precise astrophysical tests that this redshift for the light that comes from the sun, you know, is of the order of one part in a million. If you take a white dwarf, which is a star which is burnt out its fuel, so it's of the approximately the mass of the sun, but the radius is very small, so this high density star, so the gravitational field on its surface is very strong, and the white dwarf, the stretching of the wavelength is one part in 1,000, and for the neutron star, it is one part in 10, you see. So this is truth. Experiment agrees with Einstein's theory. That's the first one. The second one is the very famous one, the bending of light by massive objects, which was also in this movie. There's a long story with it, but here is the basic idea. Okay, this is a heavy object, like the sun or some star or galaxies. And there is another star over here which is giving out light. So if this object was not here, then this light would have just gone straight, right? But starlight is bent by the gravitational field of the sun as dictated by the principle of equivalence. And what you will see if you have a telescope here is that the star is shifted, the position of the star is shifted by a very small angle. Okay. It is this small angle that Eddington and others, Campbell and others, set out to measure around the early parts of the 20th century. And the Eddington's results by now, I mean, they were very, you know, these are very difficult experiments to perform, and they were performed on the west coast of Africa, actually, during a solar eclipse, because you have to black out the light of the sun, otherwise you will not see the starlight, right? So Eddington's famous photograph is there of the shift, which was predicted by Einstein, matched with the experimental observations. And then, of course, many, many other laboratories confirmed it and improved it. And in fact, the best experimental evidence for the bending of light or of radio waves, which is the same thing, comes from what are called long baseline radio interferometry experiments, which involve lots and lots of radio telescopes positioned all over the world. It's one of the most accurate verifications of the general theory of relativity. So this is the bending of light issue, okay? And this number, which was predicted by Newton's theory, is exactly half of what Einstein's theory gives and agrees with experiment. This is the famous factor of two over here, which comes out of general relativity, okay? So this is a great triumph. It is this experiment's validating Einstein's theory that made him an overnight success, overnight celebrity, because he overthrew Newton's theory of gravitation. So then Einstein becomes a public figure, okay? Then I found a very nice little quip here that one of his assistants asked that if general relativity had not been confirmed by Eddington in the bending of light in 1919, what would you think or feel? Einstein said, "Then I would feel sorry for the dear Lord. The theory is correct anyway." Okay, so this is the second famous test of relativity, and the third famous test of relativity is the so-called perihelion of Mercury. So you see, this is what is called a perihelion. Now, you know, you learned in school that you have sun and the Mercury moves in an ellipse, okay? But the Mercury is not alone in the solar system. There are other planets. Those other planets cause perturbations on the orbit of Mercury, okay? And those perturbations are visible because Mercury is nearest to the Sun. And what happens is that there is a perihelion. How do you understand that? You see, if you draw a straight line from the center of the Sun to the point of closest approach of Mercury, this line rotates. That is, this orbit keeps on rotating. You see what I'm saying? But the rotation is very, very tiny. It is something like 5,500 seconds of arc per century. It's a very fine measurement. Okay, this fine measurement was done through the 19th century, okay, by astronomers. And they found that there was a discrepancy of 43 seconds of arc per century. Okay, there was a discrepancy from the calculation based on Newton's theory. And this 43 seconds of arc per century were produced by Einstein's theory that takes into account the fact that the Sun curves space-time around it. So this is the third great triumph of the Einstein's general theory of relativity. And believe me, to give you an idea, when Einstein first calculated the perihelion, he got a wrong answer. You know, Einstein was always improving his results as his theory became more and more perfect till he arrived at the theory. So we should not feel defeated at all. You know, there's a poster there outside that says that if you're having difficulties with mathematics, don't worry. He also had an enormous amount of difficulties with mathematics. But I think the great thing about Einstein is his personality. His personality is the real winner. He was persistent and strong in his belief. And I think he just held out. And he was never disturbed by people around him or by what anybody says. And that, I think, is it's not only just brilliance and all that. He was obviously a very clever man. But it is personality that also makes people make great contributions in science. Okay. Now, so I have given you a rundown in the 45 minutes of the development of the general theory of relativity, how the Newtonian edifice of science is replaced, but contained in an approximation in the general theory. In science, nothing gets discarded. It is always contained in the theory that comes in the future. Now, what are the new predictions of general relativity? Now, this is the three things I want to talk about. Black holes, standard model of cosmology, and gravitational waves, okay? So, all right. I won't spend too much time on any of them because we don't have the time. Now, this is a cartoon of a black hole, okay? Cartoon means a black hole is a very, very massive object. Give me an example. The Sun weighs something like 10 to the 33 grams, okay? It's a hugely heavy object. You know, but it has a very large radius. Now, you just imagine putting the mass of the Sun in another object whose radius is only 3 kilometers, which you can just see this radius around here. Put all the mass of the Sun in that small radius. Then it becomes an object called a black hole, okay? So this is a very simple point, actually. Just compress all this mass in a small radius, and beyond a particular critical radius, at 4 kilometers it is not, but at 3 kilometers it becomes a black hole. Okay, so this is a cartoon picture of a black hole, which is somewhere over here, and this is the horizon of a black hole. Horizon is a one-way gate. You fall inside, you cannot come out. Light cannot come out. That's why it's called a black hole. And I have basically put here the picture of Karl Schwarzschild, who just within 1 year of Einstein's publication of his results produced an exact solution of general relativity which describes black holes. Of course, the description of black holes by that solution take many years to understand. And there are two other very famous people actually who are involved in these from astrophysics. This is Professor Subramaniam Chandrasekhar in his office. at the University of Chicago, and this photograph was taken by me because I am from the University of Chicago. And this is Robert Oppenheimer, actually, more famously known for the Manhattan Project, but also made fundamental contribution to the connection of astrophysical black holes with the solution of Schwarzschild. And I just have a little cartoon over here for you that how a particle just comes to the horizon, goes inside, and disappears. Okay, there's a long, big story here, but this is just to whet your appetite about it. Okay, now this is a prediction of Einstein's theory that there are such solutions. Are they there in nature? Oh yes. In all these years, astronomers have by now confirmed that there are black holes are ubiquitous in the universe of various sizes, several times the solar mass, up to 100 million times the solar mass in the middle of big galaxies like our own galaxy, the Milky Way. Okay, and how do we see them? We see black holes in two ways. One, as I told you, that you know, if you have a huge mass and something behind it which is shining, then this object will act as a lens, right? The light will go around. You can't hide behind that. So the black hole looks like a big lens. And by these lensing effects, you can actually ascertain not only black holes, but a lot of information about galaxies and the distribution of matter, etc., etc. There are lots of astrophysical consequences of this. But this is one way of looking at black holes, as a lens, gravitational lens. The other way of looking at a black hole is over here, that if you have a star, actually, which is sort of whose fuel is sort of just disappearing, all its matter is getting sucked up, because you know, you cannot really see a black hole, you know, because it's black classically. So what happens is that this gas that is being sucked up goes into a very fierce rotation, rotation around the black hole, and when the matter is falling into the black hole, it is being energized by the black hole, and then the star explodes, and it gives out a certain characteristic radiation. And it is this radiation that astronomers are looking for. And in fact, this AstroSat satellite that was just launched recently by ISRO and the scientists of the Tata Institute and Raman Research Institute and others has instruments to look at the characteristic X-rays that come out of such phenomena, actually. So the Indian effort in this is also good. Okay, so this is another picture of a huge black hole in the center of the galaxy. Okay, the point of these slides is that they exist. And they were predictions of Einstein's theory. Now let's come to the next, and in my opinion, perhaps the most important consequence of the general theory of relativity, that it gives you a framework to discuss our universe, and in a sense, our place in it. And I think any theory that does this has to be taken very seriously. Clearly, this is a cartoon of modern cosmology. So there is something called the standard model of cosmology, that the universe began with a big bang. I don't know this, actually. I don't know what happened really here, okay? But maybe something like 10 to the minus 29 seconds after this event, the universe expanded, inflated, and lots of interesting things happened here. Till about 300,000 years after this event, We know the origin of the universe very, very precisely, in some sense, 300,000 years after the so-called Big Bang, because of the so-called relic radiation that was liberated and which has come down to us today, which contains the seeds of all the happenings that took place in the early universe over here. And this is the so-called cosmic microwave background radiation. So when matter actually, charged matter became uncharged by, you know, atoms and material forming in the way you know, we are not falling towards each other because we are all electrically neutral, okay? So the radiation given out at that time, okay, is then came down to us today as the cosmic microwave background radiation at a temperature of 2.74 degrees Kelvin. This is this famous cosmic microwave background radiation, which was detected around the 1960s, I think 67 or something, by people working in Bell Labs. Now, the next set of experiments found that this radiation, this is the most recent one, that this radiation actually has fluctuations. You know, the temperature of 2.7 degrees Kelvin or something is the average temperature, but there are temperature fluctuations, you see. And these temperature fluctuations tell you about density fluctuations almost 14 billion years ago, okay? And this has been verified to an amazing accuracy by this new Planck satellite, actually, which went up last year. I mean, and the framework to discuss all this, you always need a theory to discuss all this, actually, is the general theory of relativity. It is a theory of cosmology. And it tells you how to understand observations made by these satellites and these instruments in the framework of the general theory of relativity. Remember, you always need a theory to understand an experiment. Theory precedes experiment. And this is a quote from Einstein himself. You need an idea of what you're looking at, actually. So the general theory of relativity gives rise to a framework which explains this type of phenomena. It also explains this phenomena, that is the energy budget of the universe. How do you arrive at all this from those observations which the Planck satellite saw? And the energy budget is very interesting. The matter that we are familiar with makes you and me and all the experiments that we do, the atoms, electrons, everything, just is 5% of the energy budget of the universe. There's a lot to discover. That's what it says. So this is the matter we are familiar with. But then there is something called dark matter. It is matter, but matter which doesn't shine. So you can't see it. You can only see it gravitationally, okay? So that budget is 25%. But then there's something else, totally mysterious. Totally mysterious. It's called dark energy. And it is sort of, in some sense, parameterized by this number lambda, the cosmological constant, which I talked of when I showed you the cartoon of the, not cartoon, the real Einstein equations, actually, okay? So this is dark energy. And, you know, these are the great challenges of modern science. How do you explain this energy budget of the universe? And this dark energy is the one that is responsible for the accelerated expansion of the universe today. Okay. A few years ago, the guys who discovered this got the Nobel Prize. The point of this lecture is none of it actually is possible without the general theory of relativity. This is the key point I wanted to make. Okay? Now let me come to the last thing, which is not yet done, but in which I think actually that science will be different before and after this discovery. And I'll tell you what it is, really. So, gravitational waves are a new probe of astronomy. Now, what are gravitational waves? Okay. So, you know that if you have a pond of water and you throw some heavy object in it, there'll be ripples of waves, actually. Okay. So, gravitational waves are precisely ripples in the fabric of space-time caused by agitating objects, like neutron stars circling around each other and falling into each other. Okay. Pulsars doing that, okay? Or two black holes colliding, you know, will shake up the fabric of space-time in such a way that they will give rise to these gravitational waves. Now, the interesting thing about why gravitational waves are so important is because, okay, let me just back up a little bit. So you know about electromagnetic waves, you know, you accelerate charged particles, you get electromagnetic waves, they're all over there. These are all electromagnetic waves, okay? Very nice. But electromagnetic radiation can be screened. You know, what I'm trying to say is that once you have neutral objects don't radiate. So when the universe became neutral electrically 300,000 years after the Big Bang, that's it. You can only glean what happened before by other theory considerations, okay, or some other signatures in the cosmic microwave background radiation. Because you can't see directly below because it's neutralized. And there was a plasma actually, so the electromagnetic wave will be lost actually before this cosmic microwave background radiation was liberated. Now the great thing about gravitational waves is that it cannot be stopped by anybody. It can go far before electromagnetic waves. I mean, in time, it can actually tell you about the universe, its birth, its what happened at the Big Bang. These are called primordial gravitational waves. Ultimately, will be able to tell us a lot about the early universe. Okay, and also about lots of different energetic phenomena which will take place in the astrophysical sky. Can be observed by gravity waves actually. So it's a new type of radiation which does not come from charged particles, which is electromagnetic waves, but by the jiggling of matter and the jiggling of the fabric of space-time. Okay, so this is... Now indirectly this has been observed by Hulsey and Taylor. I will not detail all this. But this is a new frontier that will profoundly influence our knowledge of the universe and its past and see what light cannot. So, Now, what about the detection of gravitational waves? So there is a big effort over the last several decades, mainly emanating from the United States, from Caltech, MIT, and some other institutions there, that we should be able to detect these waves by experiments on Earth. Okay. Now, this is a typical interferometer type of experiment, which I'll tell you what an interferometer is very simply. There is a laser source over here, there is a mirror over here that splits this beam into two parts. And let's say the length of this beam line is L, capital L, okay. Now when a gravity wave comes and hits this experiment from some effect in the in some part of the universe, and suppose the gravity wave is, perpendicular to this screen, okay, it comes this way. Then this wave will distort the space-time, you see, and it will distort in this following way. It will stretch this arm little bit, and it will shrink this arm little bit. Now, if this arm is stretched a little bit, and this arm is shrunk a little bit, then the time the light will take to go from here to here and here to here will be different. And so you will see an interference pattern actually. And this interference pattern is the detection, the number that characterizes the detection is extremely small. The delta L is H, which is 10 to the minus 21 times L. Now this comes out of some simple elementary theory, but bear with me. So delta L is L times 10 to the minus 21. Okay. So this requires, in order to be able to see this small number, an interferometer whose length is of the order of 1 kilometer. So these interferometers which people have constructed in the United States each have a length of 4 kilometers. So it's an interferometer which has a length of 4 kilometers. So here is the picture of that. This is the LIGO observatories in Hanford and Livingston, USA. So this is the interferometer arms. This is where the laser is. And this is where the light beams are shone this way and this way. And they come back and you see an interference pattern. And the sensitivity of the latest LIGO experiment has gone about 10 times what it was previously, and we are expecting, believe me, a result sometime early next year. I hope it happens, because I think the Indian contribution there is very, very important from our institute in Bangalore. Anyway, who? Okay, so now why do we need many such experiments all over the world? And the idea is very simple. I mean, you need to observe the gravitational radiation coming from a source or something that happened in many parts of the world, actually. And this is a very simple idea that how an owl actually detects a rat. And you know, there is an auditory stimulus here in the left ear and the right ear, and both are sort of combined in order to sort of locate that object. So it's a location problem. It's a very simple point. So now, this is where things are planned. So gravitational wave astronomy requires worldwide network of observatories, and these are the ones I talked about: LIGO in Harvard, in Hanford and Livingston. And then the Europeans are also building. In Japan also, there is a proposal. And in India, there is a proposal to build this gravitational wave astronomy laboratory. There are two sites which have been identified, I am told. One in Maharashtra near Nanded, and the other one somewhere in Rajasthan. And I think a lot of people are trying to encourage the government of India to go forth and do this, because it'll not only make India a player in cutting-edge science of this momentous discovery to happen, but it'll also bring us a lot of technology and other benefits, because these experiments are situated here. So a lot of effort is, and I thank Sudhindra for writing a press note actually making this point also. Hopefully there will be people picking it up and taking us forward. Okay, so now I'm almost out of my time. I will just summarize this talk. All of classical general relativity, in the words of Roger Blanford, somebody whom I know very well and who is on my advisory committee in Bangalore, is a very distinguished astrophysicist. He says, general relativity is now, I think, routinely accepted as the foundation of our description of the universe at large, which we call cosmology, of black holes, of neutron stars, and of small corrections to the orbits of planets and spacecraft in our own solar system. So it is a very beautiful science article that has come out in March by Roger Blanford. So this very nicely summarizes the great success of the Einstein theory of general relativity. But if this is the end, then life is not interesting. So now I have to tell you about the failures of general relativity and the present story of what we are trying to do to reach there. So unfortunately, I feel that there is no Einstein-type figure actually with that type of personality amongst all of us, my colleagues and everybody all over the world. Okay, never mind. Somebody from this audience might arise. Okay. So now there is another very big revolution that took place in the 20th century in physics, and that is called quantum mechanics. Now all of you are beneficiaries of that. This works on quantum mechanics, that camera, everything. I mean your cell phone, all electronics, none of it is possible without the fabrication of the transistor and other things, not even computing, no, nothing. So quantum mechanics was discovered around the early part of the 20th century. Einstein played a very profound role in quantum mechanics, which he didn't believe in, of course. So non-believers also have a role in augmenting a theory. The point is the following, that when general relativity meets quantum mechanics, there is trouble. And the trouble is the following. You do some calculus. See, I was talking about space-time, actually, you know, just like some smooth object, you know, just like water is smooth, right? You put your hand in water, you don't feel the atoms and the molecules, right? So space-time, actually, at this distance, at very, 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 very tiny distances, and I cannot explain, these are distances which naturally come out when you put Planck's constant and Newton's gravitational constant and the speed of light together. The length you obtain is something like 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, and this is the number of seconds. So at this point, this space-time geometry I talked about becomes very fluctuating, actually. All types of funny things happen, you know, and the fabric, actually, you don't recognize the fabric anymore. And this is just a picturesque way of saying that your calculations all lead to infinities. Okay. So general relativity, when you quantize it in the standard way in which physicists quantize ordinary theories like electromagnetism, there is a big problem. So it doesn't work. Now, how do you find a theory which will contain the Einstein theory now as a limiting case, just as Einstein found a theory which contained Newton's theory as a limiting case? How do you find it? How do you go about doing that? And I think this is the quest in which in the last 30 years or 35 years, a lot of us are sort of involved in. And you might think it's a long time, but I think it also took from Newton to Einstein was also a very long time. So I'll just summarize in this last couple of slides. Sorry for this overtime, but black holes. So as I said, string theory. See, there's a formalism, a framework again, called string theory. Okay, which says that the basic objects of interest in describing fundamental physics are not point particles, but are small stringy objects or objects of higher dimensions, actually, okay? And string theory has the tenet in it to describe a finite theory of gravity. The smooth space-time of our experience is an approximate description of an underlying structure that is needed for a complete description of gravity. And the most important point over here is that by studying black holes in string theory and other objects as laboratories, as thought experiments, we arrive at perhaps one of the most important implications of this new quest to understand the quantization of Einstein's theory, that the theory has new degrees of freedom. You see, there's something underlying space-time, which you are not able to see. Just like you know today that water is made up of molecules, and the molecules are made up of hydrogen and oxygen atoms. But when you, every day in your morning, when you use the water, you don't realize this point, right? You think it's all smooth. This is actually, I think, the main issue. What are the atoms of gravity, actually? What is this substructure of gravity that looks smooth and is described by Einstein's theory of general relativity? I'll leave you with that question. This is a very important and a very simply formulated question. What are the atoms of space-time? Okay? And this theory, string theory, also has a tenet to present a unified theory of the physical world, and this is a subject of intense current research. The last slide which I would like to show you is what is the legacy of Einstein for theoretical physics, actually? Is it just the general theory of relativity? No, it's much more than that. So it's a way of thinking that we actually deeply honor Einstein with. He changed the way we think in physics. So Einstein brought out the importance of the fundamental role of symmetry in the formulation of the laws of physics. This was an important motivation in arriving at the so-called gauge principle, which is the foundation of the standard model of elementary particles. The standard model of elementary particles, which predicted the Higgs and Higgs discovery, completed a very big chapter in the theory of elementary particles. But that theory, is a gauge theory, and the motivation, the inspiration also to look for such a theoretical foundation comes from general relativity. Okay, so that's the first point. And the second point is a little bit more intangible, and this is something which I want to stress upon, is that the discovery of the laws of nature by a logical invention based on general principles. You see, there is a very beautiful philosophical dialogue presented by Einstein in 1933 in his Oxford lecture. I invite you all to read that. It is very easy to download from the University of Chicago Library. See, basically, you know, you're taught that science has experiments, and from experiments you glean theory and then you go on. But Einstein said, no, that is not perhaps the best way of going about it. And this is how he was able to overturn Newton's theory, that, you know, he was able to set up a structure which had nothing to do with experiment to begin with. You know, the so-called logical invention, mathematical consistency, and those are the tenets that went into the creation of the general theory of relativity. So this, is, I think, also is a very important legacy of Einstein. And there's an immediate, Paul Dirac actually applied precisely these ideas of general principles of special relativity and positivity of energy to discover the famous Dirac equation. This is another one of the most important equations of the 20th century. And it was discovered not by matching experiment necessarily, but by logical thinking of general principles. And then, of course, it agreed with experiment. That is the famous Dirac equation. Already there is an example of that. And string theory today carries forward the legacy of Einstein. And its goal is to present a unified theory of all physical laws that govern our universe, or even other universes. So with that, I thank you, and I thank Einstein for his incredible legacy. And I'd like to acknowledge a few people who have helped me with this talk, is my colleague P. Ajit from GSTIFR, who is one of the leading scientists in LIGO for the slides pertaining to gravitational wave astronomy, and Juan Maldacena is a very celebrated physicist at Princeton for the animations about black holes and redshifts, and various other sources. I'm not very good at making computer pictures and all that, so I use the sources online. I'd like to acknowledge them for that. Thank you very much.